BMI of greater than 30, let alone 35 or 40, there is 3 times risk of increase of diabetes, sleep apnea, gallbladder disease, twice the risk of increase of heart disease, mortality, hypertension, and arthritis. But what's interesting is the last is 1 to 2 times increase in cancer rate, fertility problems, fetal defects, mental health issues. The mental health issues, these could be caused by the obesity, and obesity itself can cause mental health issues like diet, depression, and anxiety. The epidemiology, these are the facts. 1 in 5 individuals living in Brent, Harrow, and Ealing are recorded as obese. That's to say BMI greater than 30. So that's a lot. And they cost the NHS directly $1 billion a year. That's direct cost. Indirect cost, that's to say other services, accessing different medical departments, falls, care at home, is cost nearly $3 billion. Right. I'm not going to go through all this, but this is to say that we try to follow the NICE guidelines, because we have a lot of referrers saying, why can't we see people with BMIs of just around 30? The reason is that we couldn't cater for the numbers. So we looked at the NICE guidelines and NHS England. So we chose either people with BMI, or didn't choose, people with BMI greater than 40, or those less between 35 and 40 who have significant other health issues like diabetes, hypertension, sleep apnea, and we saw them both in the medical and the surgical. The guidelines would say that people with BMI greater than 50 should be referred directly to Mr. Supi, but we had the privilege or lack of it to actually try and help them before they get to Mr. Supi. I'm not very sure, but I think we had some success. I think we had some success, even with the BMIs greater than 50. Yeah. Right. So these are the facts. About 2,500 referrals we had in the last 11 years, but actual attendance was 1,900. Out of that, the patients received 6,000, nearly 300 appointments between the medical, the dietetics, and the surgeons. Unfortunately, a lot of the, which is about a third, kind of voted with their own free, basically saying they didn't particularly want to reduce their eating habits. They didn't want to change it. They didn't like it. Or they lost some weight and they felt better and they said that's good enough for me. So they came out of the programs, both for medical and surgical. The unfortunate bit is someone reaching up to the day of surgery and then Mr. Supi sent me an email, do you know they actually declined to have surgery? I think that's a little bit sad because that's a lot of effort and it was almost a year to 18 months to get there, and then the day of surgery they declined that. But anyway, people have made their choices and can do that. What I didn't include in this, which is not included because it's not on the trust website, is that the dietary groups, for example, in the community are not accounted for, and these are, there's a lot of activities. Yeah, there. Yeah. Helen Davis headed that, and she's had an enormous input. Telephone consultations, non-stop to Teresa, including partly counselling. We didn't have a counsellor. The LCD groups, the LCD means low-calorie diet groups, which is headed by Professor Leeds, and these were almost weekly attendances, and again, that wasn't accounted for. So these must be over a good few thousand appointments. The walk-ins who come in to ask for advice, our diabetes nurses input was not accounted for. Other medical specialities, they may refer to cardiology, gastro, or respiratory, is not accounted for. So there's a lot of input that is really just like a black hole, is not being recorded. For the medical input, Professor Lisa and myself would see them, carry out full medical examination, then send them off to Helen. If there's one-to-one dietary advice, if, according to how she sees where they are, she would actually put them either in the mindful eating group, which is a six-week,
six-week group,
or if they have been found to have eating disorder, referred to Vincent Square. Oh yeah, and she also referred them to Vay Farm for exercise and Stanmore, which will aspire. Right, Professor Lisa, I hope you don't mind I didn't hold it behind your back. So the audit is actually, I have to say, there has been over 200 who signed up to the diet, 134 who actually completed at least the 6 weeks. So I looked only on those as 6 weeks plus. Out of these, I could only find 124 full data. So average age is 54, but anything between 19 and 79. Average week on the low-calorie diet is 47 weeks, but the minimum is 6 weeks. That's because of the criteria I put for myself. And you can see that I've got a large neck circumference, a large waist circumference. The blood pressure is a little bit on the high side systolic. Now, before weight loss, the average weight at entry was 128, but you can see the weight is up to 204. So they have the high BMI, which is, you can see that, up to 63. The after weight loss on the LCD, the average weight loss is 27 kilograms for the whole group, and the average is 103, but it's, again, the range is quite big. So the 169 is that same individual who was 204 after many weeks. I think it was more than 6 weeks. He did at least 6 months and he got to that. When I looked at with male and female, the majority are females, 28 men and 96 females, and the majority are in the age range between 35 and 59. Okay, next one. Now, what happened? So, what we noticed is that men, in general, whatever age group, had a higher weight and BMI. It's missing there because there was only one man and I didn't have BMI result as hard as I looked, but I didn't want to take him out of the equation. What's interesting is that men have lost most of the weight and older men have lost more weight than younger men. I don't know what's the mystery for that. I mean, would have thought younger men would have been more active. I have no answer to that. You can only speculate. Again, this is an interesting slide. So the calculation showed that most of the weight loss is actually in the first few weeks. But as time goes on, there's likelihood of weight regain. And the reason for that is when I looked at the individual data, there's definitely, even on the LCD, know your diet. So they would lose the weight, and there's something stimulated them, and then they go back putting on some weight, and then they lose the weight. You just kept doing that. The longest in the group that Professor Lees was holding was about 4 years. He was on the diet, but he's always done that all the time. However, they never reach, at the end of it, only few have regained all the weight. So the majority have kept some of the weight off. Right, so in brief, the weight loss is achieved in all ages, all groups, all genders. Men had a higher initial weight and BMI, but they had the greater weight loss. Men, older men between 60 and 80 are the ones who achieved greater weight loss. Even remember, the sample size is small. And initially, weight loss is greater initially, but as time goes on, the rate declines. Now, for the surgical, again, I did this a small audit. So Mr. Sufi was heading the clinical lead for the team, and he would see the patient here once a month. We have an MDT, and if everyone is satisfied, they're healthy, they've done all their activities,